obviously we're going to start off with somebody that everybody's talked about and everybody has seen. Mm-hmm. But I do want to address, we're going to address some specific things, what makes Tate such an intriguing player. And in a lot of ways, it makes him a very, the type of player that you can't really predict what he's going to look like in a Dan Enos offense. Because to a certain extent, he relies so much on improvisational ability and on making something out of nothing. Mm-hmm. And that's something that you really can't get a handle unless the quarterbacks were live, which obviously you don't want to do in scrimmages because, you know, you don't want to get your QBs hurt. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like you have to see him in a game situation before you know what you have.
Right.
So I think that's going to make it really difficult, not just for us as viewers from the outside, but even for Dan Enos and Manny Diaz, because how are they going to know exactly what a Tate Martell run offense is going to look like? Mm-hmm. And we'll go over some of the things here, mm-hmm. And some of the video clips that speak to that. And additionally, we talked about this before, regardless of who the starting quarterback is, Dan Enos is going to have a Tate Martell package, because this young man he's not just an elite athlete for a quarterback. He's an elite athlete.
Right.
You try to find me a wide receiver or a running back or a DB who's usually your best athletes on the field. Mm-hmm. You try to find me one of those that has a sub-4-second short shuttle run. Mm-hmm. Tate Martell had a 3.96.
Yeah.
On the short shuttle. That's elite level athleticism. So yeah, that's the thing, regardless of what, whoever comes out as a starting quarterback, we will have a Tate Martell package. Mm-hmm. And with the video clips, you're going to see one of the reasons why.
Yeah. So let's we're going to have three of them here, three video clips. The first one we're going to cover is the run and pitch. So you want to go ahead and jump into that one?
Let's go ahead and jump in. We actually have four total.
Oh, we have four? Oh, that's right. We do have four. Okay. Yeah, we do have four.
All right, let's get started. This one, you're going to see him run out to the left. And there you see, he runs out to the left. Now watch. He's getting hit. A late option pitch out and picks up another 10 yards almost.
Yeah.
And that's the thing with Tate is you see that a lot. If you watch his high school film, and obviously in college, you know, he had that limited stint either against Rutgers or in garbage time or mm-hmm. another game or two. Not just in garbage time, though. There was a Tate Martell package that they used even in red zone or when the game was still being decided. So
right.
That's one of the things that he gives you that is immeasurable. You don't really know how to quantify it mm-hmm. because you could see the other quarterbacks. Well, he made this throw. That's a nice throw. He threw this guy open. Oh, what a nice anticipation throw. How do you balance that in what he just did there? Mm-hmm. That took a 7-yard run into a 15-yard gain. Mm-hmm. And it was because of that improvisational ability that he has. That's something that is going to give us a different look when we do use that Tate Martell package.
And let's go to the next one so we could see his running ability. You saw a little bit there on the pitch, but here you're going to see a lot more of it.
Yeah, let's go to this. This one is a 47-yard touchdown run. I want you to watch these moves. Mm-hmm. There you go. Breaks a set of ankles there, then turns on the jets. He has good straight line speed. The actual straight line speed isn't as elite as his other parts of his athleticism.
Right.
But there you see what he can do. One of the runs that we saw in high school, I'm not sure, was that the St. Thomas game? The St. Thomas Aquinas game? Yeah, he did this run that was like ridiculous. It was, he rolled out to his right and he got pressured and then he turned back to his left. I mean, it was a thing to see. He ended up getting the first down, but he probably ran 150 yards in order to get the 10 or 12 yard gain.
Right.
And it really saved the game for him. That continued, you know, Bishop Gorman was 43-0 in the games yeah. that Tate started. But there you see the running ability. And I know people keep saying, oh, well, that's Rutgers. Well, I get it. But at the same time, those type of skills are going to be impactful no matter who you play.
All right, let me say something here about those people saying that, oh yeah, Tate looked good against Rutgers. What's the whole point, man, of looking at high school film then of these kids coming in? I mean, they're not playing to the competition, you know, at the college football level, yet we get excited about what we see from them against high school competition. So those of you that are saying, oh yeah, he looked good against Rutgers, yeah, okay, whatever. I've never understood that argument, because all of these kids that we're going to see a lot more of them today and covering on the offensive side of the football, yeah, they're playing against high school kids. The majority of these high school kids are not anywhere near at the level that some of these recruits are. So they look good, and people get excited about, you know, the abilities of these high school kids coming in and looking good when you're watching their film. So you put weight on that, but you don't put weight on how Tate looks at, you know, at a college football level in live game action because it was Rutgers. I've never understood that. It's a stupid argument, in my opinion. It really is.
And by the way, how did Tate look in high school when he played St. Thomas and when he played the big-time schools in California and in Texas?
Yeah.
There's a reason why he was 43-0. So and
you just brought that up. I'm just gonna say something very quick for those of you that don't know the stats of Tate in high school. He had 148 total touchdowns in high school, 35 of which were for rushing, and with only 9 interceptions. He threw for 7,507 yards, rushed for 2,294 yards while completing, and he completed 60% of his passes. And he went 43-0,
43-0,
three straight championships. So I mean.
Three straight national championships at a school that never won one before and hasn't won one since.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, the talent is there, man. I don't understand the hate on Tate. You know, people think that he shied away. He left because Justin Fields came in Ohio State. Man, he could have gone to any other school and just been handed a starting job. But no, he came to Miami, where he knew we had Nkosi Perry, who was the front runner to start, frankly, this year because of his experience last year with the team and with Rick. He knew we had Jaren Williams, who a lot of people were excited about. Yeah, he still came in, man. He's like, you know what? I'm gonna go to Miami, and I'm going to compete for the job, and I'm going to win the job. So those of you saying that he was shying away from competition at Ohio State, why did he come down here to Miami? It makes more sense if that was the case.
It doesn't. And if you take just Power Five and Group of Five schools, there is literally close to 50 teams that Tate could have gotten on campus and been handed a starting job.
Absolutely. 100%.
You know? So he came to a place that has not one, but two top five caliber guys in their respective classes.
Yeah.
So I don't buy this. He ran away from competition. We don't know what happened before. You have to remember, he was recruited by Urban Meyer.
Right.
Okay. Urban Meyer now retires. Ryan Day takes over, who was the offensive coordinator. Mm-hmm. We don't know what type of relationship Tate had with Day. We don't know the conversations that happened between them. What was it that made Tate say, oh, this is not for me? And let's remember something. There was a reason why Ohio State did not try to get Tate his waiver, refused. There was a reason why Ohio State did not, you know, they could have battled against that the waiver, and they didn't.
Right.
So there was something going on there that they felt that, yeah, let's let him go and let's let him, you know, play right away because of something that happened there internally. Right. So we don't know. But the thing is, like you said, your point is well taken. Is if he wanted no competition, he would have gone a lot of other places other than Miami, where he could have just Florida State. There you go. That's a school just not that much farther away.
Right.
So he could have walked on at FSU because all he had back is Blackman and Hornibrook. And Hornibrook might have not even chose to transfer there if Tate would have gone there.
Exactly.
So there's a lot of other places that Tate could have gone where he did not have competition. So this whole shying away from competition, we don't know at all what happened behind the scenes.
Let's finish up on the clips, because I feel like we could hammer down this whole Tate argument like forever. So
yeah,
we saw this, go ahead.
On this third clip, one of the things that has been mentioned is that people saw him throw to his right. I want you to see what a beautiful throw to his left, throwing against his body, and not just the fact that he completed it, look at the ball placement. Look at where he places this ball. Mm-hmm. And you want to go ahead and go to it?
Yeah, let's go ahead and go to it.
There you see. He's gonna roll out to his left, extends the play, and now watch. Look where he puts this ball. Yeah. And we're going to see the dart. It not only was a dart, he threw it in basically the only play. Look at that. Beautiful touch on it. Gets it right where it needs to be between two guys.
Yeah.
So the one thing, and this sort of ties in to the fourth clip that we're going to show. The one thing with Tate is when you look at his film, and it doesn't matter if it's high school or the little bit of college, there's a lot of beautiful highlights when he's on the move. Yeah. From the pocket, that's not his strong suit. And Dan Enos does I think it's a brilliant way to coach, not just to coach, but it's a brilliant way to be a manager, to be a CEO of a company. Enos's focus and philosophy is he takes advantages of your strengths and tries to help you improve your weaknesses. Mm-hmm. And that's what he's done with Tate. We've seen him, you know, he's working with Tate on his footwork when he's under center. He's making Tate be in the pocket a little bit more. Now, that doesn't mean that when games come, if Tate happens to win the job, that doesn't mean that he's not going to take advantage of Tate's strengths. Mm-hmm. He'll probably have more shotgun if Tate was a starter. Right. He'd probably have more design quarterback runs. He'd have more RPOs. So he'll take advantage of Tate's strengths. But at the same time, especially in practices and drills, he's trying to improve his weaknesses.
Exactly.
Which I think is the way that you handle things as a coach or as a CEO. You want to take advantage of people's strengths while helping them improve their weaknesses.
Exactly.
So while at the quarterback competition for right now, Tate was running third, and there's no discussion, I think, on that. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we will see going forward how – because – we talked about it before, and Dan Enos, I think, just mentioned it about a week ago, that he said that when they reconvene, ideally, he wants to take the competition from 3 down to 2.
Right.
Okay, which is what we talked about from before. We said when they reconvene, one of these quarterbacks is going to eliminate themselves from competition, and that's going to be the quarterback who did not work as hard. Mm-hmm. Who did not focus on the mechanics, on the drills that Coach Enos gives you, who didn't learn the offense completely, who didn't work with wide receivers on their own, or tight ends also on their own.
Right.
So one of these quarterbacks is going to eliminate themselves. Yeah. Now, obviously, we have no idea which one of those three is going to be, but regardless, Enos is going to have a Tate package.
Yeah.
Now, let's get to the fourth clip. Mm-hmm. And in the fourth clip, we're going to see some of the reasons why, as a passer, especially from the pocket, Nkosi and Jaron are at different levels than Tate.
Yeah.
So let's go ahead and take a look at that one. You're going to see here a bomb for a touchdown. And I know people always just focus on the result. Okay. He steps up, connects, and a touchdown.
Yeah.
Now, this is my point on this. He had a completely clean pocket.
Yeah.
Okay. Which only happens about half the time in college football that you have an actual clean pocket to throw from.
His wide receiver had like 5 steps on his man, so that's another
correct. Thing. Right. And it wasn't a perfect throw.
Right.
You know, it was a little bit behind him. It was a little bit underthrown. Mm-hmm. You see that from Tate, that sometimes from the pocket, especially on longer patterns, the accuracy and the arm strength isn't ideal, especially if you compare it to Nkosi and Jaron. Mm-hmm. You know, we're the best deep ball throwers in Cozy. Jaron even has a superior arm strength than Tate does.
Right. And that's a point that, you know, that a lot of Canes fans make about, you know, the reason why they prefer Nkosi is because of our talent at wide receiver. I mean, they want to see the ball being thrown downfield, and they want to see shots taken downfield. So I understand that point. You know, Nkosi has the best arm out of the three. Then I would probably put Jaron and then Tate. And Tate doesn't throw, you know, as good as a spiral as Nkosi and Jaron, which is another knock on him. I understand. But at the end of the day, he's dynamic, man. And the things that he did in high school And he just has, he has something that Nkosi and Jaren don't when it comes to, you know, improvising with a play breaks down and stuff like that. So, I mean, we'll see. We'll see, because his best game was the last spring game. So maybe, you know, we've yet to see exactly what Tate can do under Dan Enos, because Dan Enos is still, you know, evaluating and seeing, you know, the best position that he could put his quarterbacks in. Because he has said it before, you know, it all depends on what quarterback is going to be. He's going to tailor his offense to that quarterback.
Correct.
And he said that. So he's not going to be like a stubborn Mark Richt where, no, this is the offense we're running no matter who comes in. No, no, no. He's going to, you know, if Jaren gets a starting role, he's going to tailor his offense to Jaren's, you know, best abilities. Same thing with Nkosi, same thing with Tate. So I feel like in the last spring game in Orlando, you know, we saw some of that. We saw Dan Enos, you know, trying to run an offense that tailors, you know, the best of Tate. And that's the reason why he succeeded. And that's the reason why he had the best day out of the three quarterbacks, in my opinion, on that day. So, I mean, we'll see. We'll see. It all depends on, like you said, you know, who works the hardest, you know, who's going to have the best knowledge of the playbook, you know, who's going to be the captain, who's going to take the reins. And, I mean, we'll see. But I am excited about Enos in that aspect, that regardless of who it's going to be, he's going to tailor his offense to the abilities of that quarterback. And that's something that, I mean, you can't ask more for that. You really can't.
You mean he's not going to run read options with Kaya?
No.
like they did. I remember when running an RPO with or a read option with Kaya, yeah. And we were going, man, he's no threat to run. Yeah. But he was a plus passer for sure. Right. So, but you're right. I mean, that's the thing. He is going to tailor. And I said regardless if it's Nkosi or Jaren is the starter, we will have a Tate package, mm-hmm. that will be, you know, full of RPOs, of quarterback, of design quarterback runs, of things that Tate does very well. Right. We will have that package. We'll see it in the red zone. Mm-hmm. The problem when we talk about arm strength, and people place so much emphasis, and now mind you, if you have a quarterback who can throw deep, it at least makes the defense have to cover a lot more territory.
Yeah.
Okay. We saw that with the Dolphins years ago. Chad Pennington, when we had that 11-5 season, mm-hmm. under Chad Pennington, and then we went to the playoffs, and the Baltimore Ravens basically said, okay, we're going to cover you 30 yards from the line of scrimmage.
Exactly.
And we're going to suffocate you. See if you can throw it deep. And yeah. Of course, Pennington couldn't. And we ended up, I think it was the final was 20-0 or
I don't want to think about it.
We got destroyed by the Ravens. But so you do need a quarterback that has a sufficient arm to get it deep, because you force the defense to have to respect that.
Right.
Okay. But here's the thing that I want people to understand. Those deep shots that you're talking about, you take what, 4 or 5 a game, maybe at most.
Right.
Okay. You might throw the ball 35 times. So 85%, you know, and I'm just picking that number out of the hat, but 85% more or less of your throws are going to be intermediate and short.
Right.
Okay. That's where I think that's one of the reasons why we both had Jaren as starting, because intermediate and short, there's no doubt who the best passer is, and that's Jaren Williams, mm-hmm. in terms of most consistent, most accurate, and throwing with the most touch.
Right.
Not
being a big knock on Nkosi. I mean, he has the best arm, but sometimes, you know, he throws a slant, a 5 to 7 yard slant, and he's launching it like he's throwing a 30-yard bomb.
Correct.
A 30-yard goal route. So that's correct. Something we've seen about Nkosi, though, where he lacks touch sometimes, and oh no, the receiver dropped the ball. Well, maybe if he didn't throw it 100 miles per hour on a 5-yard slant, maybe he would have came down with it. So
And the thing with Nkosi, what I've noticed is, because he does show beautiful touch on some throws, mm-hmm. is the clean pocket. If Nkosi is not rushed, mm-hmm. he can show, you know, that touch.
Right.
The problem is when he's being rushed and his mind speeds up, his arm does the same.
Yeah.
And then he ends up throwing, like you said, not putting proper touch, yeah. bullying a shorter throw,
right.
missing on a short to intermediate throw.
Mm-hmm.
Because his footwork, his platform's not right. So mm-hmm. it seems like Nkosi, one of the things I know Coach Edens is working on is he's making his feet speed up, Because the problem is when your brain speeds up because you're being pressured, mm-hmm. if you don't speed up your feet, then your tendency is to overspeed your arm.
Yeah.
And that's when you throw balls with improper touch.
Exactly.
And that also ends up screwing up your accuracy.
Right.
Now, so
we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. We had to cover Tate, obviously, because he was a transfer and he's one of the guys coming in with Surge 19.
Little. Yoga.